The next item on the further revised order paper is a motion on cavity wall insulation in Northern Ireland housing executive properties. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour 30 minutes for this debate. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. We'll also ask the clerk to read the motion.
That this Assembly calls on the Minister for Communities to hold the Northern Ireland Housing Executive to account for its failure to address the lack of, or poor quality of, cavity insulation within many Housing Executive properties, and calls on the Housing Executive to formulate a plan of action to ensure that all its properties have adequate and proper cavity insulation.
Thank you, and I call Mr Alex Easton to move the motion.
Thank you, Mr Speaker, and I move the motion. I would ask that members indulge me and allow me a few moments to explain why I propose this motion and the reason for the wording. The issue of cavity wall insulation has been raised many times in the last few years by nearly all of us in this chamber in some form or another, and has been debated recently here in the Assembly, last in November 2013. Sadly, little has changed. I know that members such as Roy Beggs, Andy Allen, Pat Sheehan, Patsy McGlone, Stephen Agnew have all expressed interest with Assembly questions and met with the industry and different residents and have had the seriousness of the issue explained to them, so I'm hoping that I will have cross-community support here today. Just now acknowledge that there are UK-wide issues with regard to deterioration of certain insulation materials such as fibre over time and exposed to water and quality of workmanship. This is a problem not only for the Housing Executive, but across all total housing stock. In the mid-1980s, the Housing Executive carried out an extensive programme of insulating cavity walls across the housing stock, which was twice what it is today. The programme was in many ways ahead of its time, but nearly 30 years have passed and many problems are now coming to light. In November 2013, I brought a similar motion to the Assembly on today's topic, and after a lively debate, the motion received all parties' support. The debate covered many of the issues around fuel poverty, the health issues from cold, damp homes, and the opportunity to create jobs and reduce consumer bills. I therefore wish to focus on what actions have occurred since the motion was passed and update members on my views of progress to date. Following the motion, several members of the Assembly inquired after progress, including the current minister himself. We were all referred to a study which had been commissioned by the Housing Executive. This has become known as the CERC report, which was done by the South Eastern Regional College. We were told that this would determine the condition of the insulation and cavities, and the Housing Executive would, and I quote, carry out evaluation of the results to determine if there is substandard insulation within their properties, and will develop whatever action plan is indicated with new strategies and policies. And further, that the project would provide an evidence base to underpin a programme of remedial work if required. All sounds good so far. The study was commissioned, a report duly completed, 206 properties were thoroughly investigated, the report was completed in March 2014, and the report found that 39% of cavity walls were in severe and critical needs, 26 were unsatisfactory with grave needs, 11% were in significant need, 14% needed specific needs, and only 9% were fit for purpose. The report was then suppressed by the Housing Executive and only published after questions in the Assembly. It was finally released with two important provisions. Its publication included the following letter from the then Director of Regional Services for the Housing Executive. And as they say, as a result of the findings contained in this report, a much larger survey is being commissioned as part of the stock condition survey of Northern Ireland Housing Executive properties commencing in the autumn of 2014. This will inform the future strategy and programmes required to address the issues in the report. It calls the report small, yet the sample of 206 houses were all houses included in the 2011 house condition survey and noted as being in good condition. The HCS provided robust data to inform on fuel poverty, energy efficiency, quality of housing stock and state of repair. It is quoted extensively throughout government, yet the sample used in it was only 0.18%. In comparison, the CERC sample was 0.31%, nearly double. It also appears we were misinformed as to the purpose of the study, as it has now become a small-scale exploratory research study which aimed to provide an initial indication. The Director of Regional Services goes on to add, as a result of the findings contained in this report, a much larger survey is being commissioned as part of the stock condition survey. So CERC is condemned to the dustbin, but at least a bigger survey is going to be done. The larger survey is commonly known as the Savile Report, and thanks to questions from other parties, we now know it's cost £4 million. It was a holistic, detailed, a formidable body of work. It examined over 22,000 houses for thermal efficiency and other issues, and over 22,000 individual lofts were examined. Not at the moment. Yet amazingly, not one single cavity wall was inspected or borescoped. So a much bigger, more expensive study was completed, yet for some reason the Housing Executive chose to ignore the findings of the CERC report or to investigate further. In replies to questions about cavity wall installations over the last year or more, the Housing Executive has now put forward a consistent response regarding the issue, namely they intend to investigate further through their ECM schemes and carry out samples of borescopes to decide a programme of works, and they will deal with individual houses on a response basis. The ECM programme they refer to, which is the external reciprocal maintenance, and it includes roofs, walls, fences, etc. It is my understanding that the specifications for this work has already required inspections of walls, but I'm glad to see that the Housing Executive are now saying they are committed to carrying out these inspections. This answer is a reasonable approach, which has some merit until you dig in further and ask what is actually happening. In October last year, Roy Beggs asked how many cavity walls had been surveyed under the ECM programme. The Housing Executive, as this intrusive approach has only comments recently, that the Housing Executive is unable to provide the information requested. Would the member like in now?
I find it quite astonishing that that answer was not able to be given. But what I also find quite astonishing is that, knowing from the report which had been carried out from the smaller sample that there was major defects with cavity wall insulation, why Savile was not required to carry out further investigation and why it was not commissioned to ensure that that would happen?
I totally agree with the member. So, should have included that. So it appears they still haven't started this yet. Likewise, the claim to deal with individual houses on a response basis seems hollow. The CERC report identified 135 houses across our other constituencies, and had serious deficiencies with their wall insulation. The Housing Executive have answered questions from the Minister stating that two houses have had remedial work carried out over the last 3.5 years, not very responsive by any definition. In 2005, I asked via the Minister how many claims have been made against the Housing Executive for substantial cavity wall insulation problems. I was told the information was not available under that classification, but would be included under dampness, that over 200 claims have been dealt with. The Housing Executive often use the term lifestyle issues to explain dampened walls. In many cases, it's more likely to be the lack of cavity or poor cavity wall insulation. As such, in December 2006, I asked another question through the Minister. This time I asked how many cases of damp have been reported to the Housing Executive over the last 4 years. The answer horrified me. The answer was 25,000 cases in the last 4 years. In my own constituency, I see this repeated time and time again, but I am totally frustrated by the approach of the Housing Executive. I have been involved in trying to resolve a complaint for a tenant in these last few months, which highlighted the approach adopted by the Housing Executive. The usual excuses were lifestyle choices, condensation, not using heating properly, and airing the house. The real reasons was there was no cavity wall insulation in that person's property. And we excerpt from the lady when the Housing Executive did fix. She said, until you lived in the house without insulation problems, you will never know how much stress and worry that I had. I'm trying to keep a nice home for it to be ate up by black, dangerous mould, having to constantly strip back wallpaper, wash walls with antifungal, and redecorate. She went then on to say, once the Housing Executive had actually bothered to resolve the situation, I feel like a weight has been lifted off me, as I will no longer have to worry about the mould making us sick and that I no longer have to redecorate. In closing, I would like to state I understand the Housing Executive has financial restraints and must prioritise their budget, but I think having a warm home free from damp would be at the top of everybody's wish list. From my experience and those of my constituents, a plan is not apparent, and very little progress appears to have been made on the motion passed in this Assembly over 3 years ago. This is why I believe the Minister needs to ensure this is remedied and progress monitored and the Housing Executive are held to account. A plan has to be developed. It will not be a quick fix. It may take a decade, but we need to have a plan and it needs to be delivered. Thank you.
Called Mr. Fran McCann.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I think that just on the comment on the last thing, and I understand that a lot of the stuff is based in the rent savills, but my memory serves me right back in 2007-2008 that Savills had come in again, and they were actually heavily critical of the Housing Executive for what they called over-maintaining their homes. And they I think, brought them to decent home standards plus, and after that there was a reduction in the level of maintenance that they were carrying out in homes. So I think it has its genesis back in 2008, which I always thought was a foolish decision, and made it at the same time. We can't over-maintain our houses. The better they are, the better they're for the tenants that live there. But in fact, cavity insulation and all insulations is crucial to maintaining the fabric of any home and the well-being of those who live there. I'm sorry, this motion does not also include, although I support it, and include the thousands of people who own their own homes who, because of their financial circumstances, can't afford to insulate or upgrade their homes. I do understand that some years ago, when the SDLP had the ministry, they removed a number of grant options which allowed grants for people to renovate and upgrade their properties, which would have included heating, new windows and the upgrade of the fabric of their homes. This ill-thought-out decision by the SDLP minister at that time has ensured that people, some of them the most vulnerable in our community at present, see their homes continue to deteriorate and will quite likely be the slums of the future, thus costing more to put right in the end. In recent times, there are people who live in relatively new homes and who suffer the consequences of poor insulation. I think of people, the likes of people who live in Lagmore, where contractors did not adequately insulate these homes. And from that, there's an onus on the Housing Executive, who had these homes constructed, to pursue those who made the mess. If that is not possible, then there is a duty from the housing provider to put right this problem. I turned to tower blocks, where insulation is non-existent in many of them, and people who live in the flats are living in freezing and damp conditions. The only advice they are given, as you said, that is leave your windows open. I had occasion several months ago to have the Minister for Communities visit Divis Tower. He's seen the flats for himself, which are well kept by the tenants, but the complaints were the same. The lack of insulation makes them a cold house for them to live. This is a place where tenants sit wearing heavy coats watching TV. Of course, these are not the only flats which suffer these problems. I'm sure many in this house who see the same conditions in their own areas. What was so annoying for me was the Minister was looking at these conditions and speaking to tenants, and I thank him for his visit, and I believe that he had a great deal of sympathy for the plight of tenants. But the Housing Executive Board, which was to meet several weeks later, had on their agenda for that meeting a decision on the strategy and the future of all tower blocks, which included options which would see the demolition of those they wanted rid of and those they needed to remain. Also included was investment in those blocks of flats which needed immediate investment. I understand that Divis Tower was included in that. What did they do? They fudged the matter by putting any decision back a number of months. So tenants and tower blocks who were waiting on good news at Christmas, and instead they got a slap in the face. This board, who are looking at removing all tower blocks over a period of time, saying that they are not financially viable and should be demolished. What they have missed is we are dealing with people and their living conditions, not a strategy. Any demolition could take over 25 years to unfold, and would take that length of time before they got to Divis Tower. What they did not look at is a chronic problem faced by tenants. They did not discuss what way tenants felt or if they would be in a position to house people from Divis or any other tar black. In fact, people are happy living in Davos. Yes, well, certainly.
I thank the member for giving way. And would the member agree with me that residents in Davos Flats have had problems from the day and hour that tar block was built?
Yeah, and
there
had been a number of attempts in the past. There was something, and the repairs that were carried out at that time done nothing to remedy the problems that exist there. It's pure heating, bad insulation, and certainly there are no insulation, should I say, and a serious problem with dampness. People looking into the flats, and if they did decide that the flats were surplus to requirements, where would they put the tenants? West Belfast has the longest waiting list in the north, with over 4,000 people looking housed. And what would they do with those tenants and the other blacks who wish to remain in their locality, which is often the case? Have they properties to move them to? The decision taken by the Housing Executive Board not to proceed with investment in Davos Tower has condemned tenants to live in a never-ending nightmare. The replacement of windows and heating with proper insulation could transform these flats and the lives of those who live there. Yes, certainly.
Would the member agree with me too that while the situation in the tower blocks is dire, many homes in rural areas are solid wall, no cavity wall insulation, no insulation at all, and that something needs to be done to rectify that situation, especially given the health, COPD, asthma and other respiratory conditions as a result of it?
Yes, I would certainly agree that.
The member to conclude his remarks.
The housing executive sit today with roughly 80,000 houses and their stock, many of them 20 years old, some far older. Chair, but I think the point is well made by the member that often when we speak about housing, we forget about the serious problems around rural areas. Thank you very much.
Call Mr. Andy Allen.
And can I take this opportunity to thank the member for bringing this important motion before the House and thank the Minister for coming here today to listen to the concerns of members across this House. Mr. Speaker, if we look at the Department for Communities' current statutory minimum fitness standard for housing, it outlines one of the criteria is a home should be free from dampness prejudicial to the health of the occupants. It further states, under the fitness standard, a dwelling is fit for human habitation unless in the opinion of the relevant authority, it fails to meet one or more of the above requirements. It also further on it states that there should be a reasonable degree of thermal comfort. Associations should take the opportunity to improve the energy efficiency and install installation that meets current NI building regulation standards. Providing a reasonable degree of thermal comfort requires efficient heating and effective insulation. The Northern Ireland Energy Strategy, which was updated on the 18th of January 2017, states to achieve sustainable progress towards a 34% improvement in the energy efficiency of housing stock in Northern Ireland over a 10-year period, there is no doubt energy efficiency is the best way in which to tackle fuel poverty. Mr. Speaker, we're told within the programme for government that there's a major desire to tackle fuel poverty, and one of those key ways is by addressing the lack thereof of cavity wall insulation in housing executive homes and indeed the poor quality, because at the time that many of these homes were built, often the highest industry standard was used, but unfortunately as we progressed in the years, those standards have improved more and the materials used then have become not fit for purpose. We have on many occasions in this House discussed the need for new social housing, and indeed we point to the 40,000+ people on the social housing waiting list, and we demand that the Minister do more, and I welcome the fact that he announced his commitment, although this House is coming down and the Minister leaves office on the 1st of March. I welcome the fact that he committed to build 9,600 new social starts, and also commit to funding 3,750 co-ownership homes. And it's important that we build new homes and we invest in new homes for people, but it's also vitally important that we invest in our current stock and bring them up to a standard as fit for purpose and habitation. Mr. Speaker, I've attended many constituents' homes.
I'm glad you raised the fact about the 9,600 houses, which is essential in trying to deal with a long waiting list. But I think we need to be adventurous in what we look at in terms of housing and those that are getting built. More recently, I've seen an article on TV where there are a number of factories open in England with pre-packed houses which have the highest energy standards, which are well built, well put together, and could provide an alternative at half the price of a normal house.
I thank the member for his intervention. And indeed, whilst I realise that the Minister has said that 9,600 homes is an ambitious target, I would like to see that go beyond that. And indeed, if we look at the housing growth indicators in the regional development strategy, it points to 6,000 plus units per year to address the housing shortage. So I believe the 9,600 target is ambitious, and I commend the Minister for setting that, but I don't think it goes far enough, and I believe we need to be challenging ourselves to set those targets higher. As I was saying there just before the member's intervention, we hear often in this House the need to improve our current housing stock to ensure it's fit for habitation. And indeed, Mr Speaker, I've attended many constituents' homes. I've seen pictures of shocking standards of homes. Is he looking in there? Sorry. I couldn't see whether he wanted in there or not. And indeed, I've seen the shocking standard. And quite often, constituents are being informed by the housing executive staff, who are often operating under severe financial constraints. But that's not an excuse. We cannot afford to take our eye off the ball and allow constituents to live in houses that are not fit for standard. I've seen walls, ceilings that are covered in complete black moss. And they're told quite often, as Mr Easton quite rightly pointed out, that is lifestyle choices. It's the lack of heat. Or it's too much heating, it's the lack of ventilation, and it's condensation developing. And quite often, in many cases, it's a result of the lack of cavity wall installation. And it's important to recognise that quite often that was not the intention. No one set out to provide poor housing. No one set out to provide housing with lack of cavity wall or poor materials that would deteriorate over years. They provided housing to the best of the standard at that time, but we've progressed, we've moved on, and we've advanced, and it's important that we adapt and we overcome the difficulties in front of us. There's no denying that over the next 20 years, as produced in the Savills report, that the Housing Executive is going to be facing severe financial constraints in order to maintain and bring its level of housing stock up to a fit-for-purpose standard. And it's important we as members do all we can to challenge indeed the Minister, but also we constructively add to the debate and the argument and support the Minister within the statutory committees and within this House for alternative ideas and options that can be taken forward in order to maintain our housing stock. In finishing, Mr Speaker, I'd like to share with this House a recent constituent inquiry that I came across. It's in relation to the affordable
wealth. Conclude his remarks.
Mr Speaker, will the Minister give a commitment to meet with me in relation to an issue I've discovered around affordable warmth, where a constituent is being penalised on low income because
Members,
they...
time is up. Call Ms Nicola Mallon.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. I rise to support the motion. My view on the critical importance of housing and the intrinsic role it plays in successfully tackling disadvantage, driving economic growth and job creation, and creating a better environment and a healthier, more equal, shared society is well documented, and I have articulated several times on the floor of this House. I think it's also well known that I believe that there are five human rights. I believe the people have the right to food, to healthcare, to education, to work and to a home. And that I believe that access to a secure, affordable and good quality home is the anchor, it is the glue which holds other aspects of an individual's and a family's life together. We know the extent of the problem that the motion is trying to address. We see it every day in our constituencies, and certainly in North Belfast, where the vast bulk of my constituency work is housing related. I see it almost on a daily basis. And I see on a daily basis the intrinsic connection between health and housing, which I think is perhaps most starkly laid bare in terms of the motion before us and the issues that we are debating today. The extent of this problem Its prevalence in both social housing and in the private rented and in the homeowner section has been well documented by other members, so I therefore don't intend to repeat the statistics. But Mr Speaker, I, like many members in this House, could paint the walls of this chamber with photographs of the homes of my constituents that are black with mould and damp, where little children's bedrooms, the corners are completely black, where parents are spending a fortune trying to clean it, trying to decorate over it, and where their children are suffering a series of respiratory conditions as a result. I can also, like many members, share with you the bureaucratic battle that you have on a daily basis, because when your constituent comes to you for help, you then contact the environmental health team in the respective council area, and then you engage in a protracted debate with the housing executive over what is actually at the root of this problem. Because there is a case continuously put forward by the housing executive that it is in fact a ventilation issue, a condensation issue, and the solution lies in simply opening the window. I want to make it clear, Mr Speaker, that I am not using this opportunity to level universal criticism at the housing executive or the many, many good people that work and deal with me and many of us here in this chamber. I do believe, though, that the reluctance to accept the real reason for this issue lies in one of resource. They simply don't have the resource to deal with the problem, and therefore there is a reluctance to acknowledge it in the first instance. But as a result, Mr Speaker, the cost is paid by the individuals and by the families who live in these homes. They pay for it through their health, they pay for it when they try to clean it and redecorate it, and they pay for it through the fuel and the warmth that is lost in their homes. The cost to these families is unacceptable. It also brings me on to the second point that a number of members have touched on, and that is the issue of fuel poverty. We have the highest rates of fuel poverty here on these islands, and we urgently need a more effective and coordinated fuel poverty strategy which properly deals with this issue, and this should be a critical strand of it. Not only will it try to address our fuel poverty crisis, but it will also create employment opportunities and opportunities within the construction sector that could benefit our economy right across the north. Mr Speaker, I have to say, I am very frustrated. I am very frustrated that on the final day of this Assembly, we are debating an issue that impacts on so many homes across Northern Ireland. I am really frustrated that we have a housing crisis. I am really frustrated that we're not able to move forward on reform of the common selection scheme. Yes.
And would the member agree with me that the competing priorities and the lack of resource in terms of funding for to address the issue of cavity wall insulation, because the cost to the public purse would be around £140 million, and that doesn't seem to be money that is readily available in current circumstances.
The member has an extra minute.
I agree with the member, and I do think it's regrettable that it seems that money can be found quite easily by this executive for other things, and maybe not so easily found when it comes to issues that are impacting on homes that are being detrimental to children's health. But Mr Speaker, I just want to end on this. We have a housing crisis. We need to stop tinkering around the edges. We need to actually deal with the problems. We need to be creative. We need to be courageous. We don't need to be stuck in a political paralysis, because the price is being paid by our constituents who are living in homes that just aren't fit for purpose. Thank you, Mr Speaker.
Call Mr Stuart Dixon.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. I too welcome the opportunity to speak on this motion today, and to thank Mr Easton for raising the matter in front of us. For the last number of years, and quite rightly so, the impact on the poor people who live in housing executive homes is manifest and has been clearly demonstrated by others in this debate this morning. Housing has and remains a sector that moves from one crisis to another. in Northern Ireland. Over the last number of months, we have debated the need for improvement in the housing selection scheme, the recent reclassification of housing associations by the Office of National Statistics, and the need to protect the vulnerable from unscrupulous landlords in the private sector. But today we return to the issue of the lack of or poor quality of cavity wall insulation in housing executive properties. On the surface, this might seem to be a fairly innocuous issue, but when you look at the Northern Ireland's context of having, as others have said, the highest rate of fuel poverty in the United Kingdom at 42% and rising excesses of winter deaths at 11%, we see the positive role that effective insulation can and could play in protecting the vulnerable in our population. Mr Speaker, over 30 years ago I was elected to Carrickfergus Borough Council on the back of many local campaigns, and I can proudly state today that I have been a tenant of two housing executive properties in my early married life, and I know exactly at first hand what it was like over nearly probably now 40 years ago to live in housing executive properties that suffered from that type of damp. I've also seen kids chase the plastic beads down the street many years ago when the first cavity wall insulation schemes were being introduced. This is an issue that I have known virtually every single day of my political career, both as a councillor and as an MLA, when people have come to me and I understand at first hand the serious problems of health, the serious problems of the damage that the failure to be able to live in a decent, warm home can create for many, many people in our communities. This issue, as I've said, is nothing new. Properties that were built in the 40s to the early 90s, many of which are no longer fit for purpose because people struggle to heat them. Mr. Speaker, the statistics reinforce this.
Yes, I will.
Member for giving way. Would the member agree with me that in trying to address the fuel poverty situation for our families within their homes, that a project was put before the department from the housing executive to fit photovoltaic panelling that would have allowed our homes to have been heated at a lesser cost, and that it would have actually went a long way towards eradicating fuel poverty. But unfortunately, the department did not. They kicked it out.
Member has an extra minute.
Yeah, I thank the member. I think what she has raised is an important issue. There are many creative and innovative ways in which we can deal with the problems around both fuel poverty and also about the serious issue of the problems that the lack of cavity wall insulation or failed cavity wall insulation, as is quite often the problem today, causes for many. But this isn't just about bashing the housing executive here today, because I am a staunch supporter of the Northern Ireland Housing Executive. I believe they've done an amazing job with their hands tied behind their backs by many politicians, some of whom are represented in this chamber today. Stated in the motion, it's not just appropriate to hold the housing executive to account. This issue is well known to previous DSD ministers, Lord Morrow, Nelson McCausland, and Mr Speaker, the minister today. I wish the DUP were as consistent in their approach to heating homes as they are to heating sheds. It's vitally important to remember that the Housing Executive is carrying out a vital executive role in dealing with properties on behalf of tenants. Recent figures have stated that the Housing Executive requires somewhere in the region of £6.7 billion over the next 30 years to address maintenance issues and raise their properties to an acceptable standard. Moreover, the reclassification of housing associations has added more debt on the Housing Executive and has placed it in an unhelpful situation. I am clearly someone who supports the work of the Housing Executive, and I believe that where we have headed over many years recently has been away from support for the Housing Executive. I value the work that housing associations have done, but what should be core to providing safe, good quality public housing in Northern Ireland should be the Northern Ireland Housing Executive. I do not agree with the decision, Mr Speaker, that they should be prevented from building more homes in Northern Ireland. That may sound controversial, but Mr Speaker, I believe the Northern Ireland Housing Executive should be given the opportunity to build more homes. Today we need to see environmental health officers, building control officers, the housing executive and the department coming together to help us build homes fit not just for the future, but homes fit for people now, today. Thank you.
Call Mr. Roy Beggs.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I rise also to support the motion as far as it goes, which highlights the failure to date of addressing the defects and the poor quality of cavity wall insulation. But there is a need to go further. The Department of Social Development and its Minister, and indeed the current Department for Communities, and the programme for government, the draft programme for government, have a key role in enabling the Housing Executive through resourcing to address the failings. So what did previous Social Development Ministers McCausland, Storey and the current Minister with responsibility, Paul Given, MLA, do about it? Very little, it seems. And the fuel poverty is identified when more than 10% of a household income is spent providing heat for the home. In Northern Ireland, that is one of the highest rates throughout the United Kingdom, some 42%. Now, fuel poverty is influenced by the income of the house, the amount of energy it takes, the cost of energy, and also the domestic energy efficiency of the home. The only one of those issues which is directly under the responsibility of the Minister and the Housing Executive is energy efficiency. And that's an issue which there is a responsibility to address when there are difficulties. Walls form the largest surface area of any home and have the greatest potential to radiate or lose heat from the house. To date, the major defects in cavity wall insulation have not been addressed. It has been known authoritatively since the publication in March 2014 of the cavity wall inspection report produced by the South Eastern Regional College in conjunction with the Northern Ireland Housing Executive, that there are major defects with cavity wall insulation within Northern Ireland Housing Executive homes, and indeed many private sector homes which may have been originally Housing Executive homes. Cavity wall insulation is an issue which was examined in detail by the, which was not examined in detail by the Housing Conditions Survey. And in answer to an Assembly question, AQW 9010, the Minister acknowledged that despite the millions of pounds of Savile Housing Survey, the current quality of cavity was unknown. But back to the Cavity Wall Inspection Report, and in it, were advised that some 206 homes from throughout Northern Ireland, which had previously been surveyed in housing condition surveys in 2009 and 2011, were examined in detail using physical investigative methods. Holes would have been drilled, borescope cameras would have been inserted to see exactly what is inside the walls. And what were the results of that? The results of that were 39% had severe and critical needs, severe and critical. 26% were unsatisfactory with grave needs, and 11% had significant needs. So some very major problems were identified. The report also highlights that build desk software analysis of blown fibre would question its use in Northern Ireland. This is the private sector analysis of methods of providing insulation for its for homes. We have a wet, damp climate in Northern Ireland, and it's widely known that blown fibre can have difficulties in such climates. Unfortunately, there's a very high proportion of Northern Ireland Housing Executive homes that have blown fibre that was installed in the 1980s. It may be as high as 60 or 70%. So we have a very high risk of difficulties in these areas. It's also widely known that there, originally there were poor techniques used for installing such fibre, and there were voids, there was poor quality control. Then you add to that the damp that can occur, and instead of the insulation providing a warm home, it actually acts as a thermal bridge and conducts the heat from many of those suffering fuel poverty to the outside world, so they end up living in cold, damp homes. Indeed, I have visited constituents in Carrickfergus where damp has been highlighted as a problem, where constituents have assured me that they have regularly kept their windows open for circulation, but where officers frequently blame, or and landlords blame the tenants for lifestyle, where the real cause may well be damp, blown fibre insulation. And that's why we need a detailed survey. We need to use modern technology, thermal imaging and borescopes to deal with this problem, and funding from the department to deal with it. Regrettably, not that.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I'm not going to speak too long on this because many people before me have confirmed actually what we already know. Housing executive homes, unfortunately, those of that are quite an age, are in such poor repair that we are letting down our community. Poor insulation causes health issues. It creates social stigma and leaves people angry and alone, often coming to us politicians as a last chance option. I fortunately went along to a beautiful development in Cumber, where I saw firsthand the type of energy efficient home that I would love our community to be able to live in. The energy efficiency solutions that was put into those homes meant that those people would be able to heat their homes for as little as £5 a month. £5 a month. How much money are the people who are currently living in housing executive homes with cavity wall insulation problems, how much are they paying to try to heat their homes per month? It's definitely not £5 per month. Housing executive stock has homes that are substandard. There is mould and poor quality insulation. And like many have said here, I have been in homes across my constituency where those wee white balls of insulation blow through the vents in the walls into the homes during the day. They're not insulating the homes, they're being chased around floors with brushes and vacuum cleaners being hoovered up out of the way. Maintenance is not good enough, and I appreciate completely that the housing executive maintenance teams are under terrible pressures, but that does not forgive the attitudes of poor customer services, and I think that's what we tend to forget. The people who live in these homes are customers, but it's perceived that they have no choice and they will simply put up with mould, drafty homes, disgusting condensation and children living in bedrooms that you wouldn't put animals in. And I have to say that the attitudes that are shown to some of my customers leave them sitting in my office in tears, leave them wondering, are they going to heat the house or are they going to eat? Because many of the people that we hear about who are forced to choose to eat or heat live in the housing executive homes that we are talking about today. And I have to ask the Minister, perhaps today he could be very clear on what plans he's actually taken forward to make sure that the housing executive maintenance have enough money and are actually going through a good enough plan to stop this from happening across our countryside. I will indeed.
The Speaker, like every single speaker so far, has mentioned the financial constraints on the housing executive. Would the member agree with me that there are ways out of this problem of lack of resources to deal with cavity wall insulation and damp and mould, and so which affects houses in every constituency? Would she agree with me that one obvious way forward, which is not being explored, would be to give the housing executive the power to borrow money on the markets? It's never been cheaper to borrow, never been cheaper to borrow. And also to stop the madness of dropping corporation tax and give the money, probably 300 million quid, according to some estimates, to the housing executive to finance a crash programme of building social housing. Could we also stop the gradual sort of and surreptitious privatisation of the housing executive and its stock, which is changing the housing market for the worse? Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.
It should be a brief intervention. The member has an extra minute.
Thank you very much, and I do thank the member for bringing that up. My very next point is about this. Fresh Start had £500 million that was set aside for integrated education and shared housing. How much of that money has been spent on shared housing, on these new homes that our people do need, people with better insulation, better heating options, more energy efficient? How much was spent? But that's because the Minister doesn't, of course, believe that shared housing is important. I support the motion before the House today, and I do thank Mr. Easton for bringing it forward. It's unfortunate that it comes on a day when the room's empty, because I'm sure every single politician that's worth their salt in this building actually has housing executive tenants who are complaining. Yes, I will indeed. Thank you.
Is the member aware that virtually the same motion came forward almost 4 years ago? And what has happened since then?
Absolutely nothing, as far as I can see from my tenants, because their complaints have been going on for not 4 years, not 5 years, maybe 10 years. and it's very disappointing to find that it is back in front of this House with an almost empty chamber today. I do support the motion today. I acknowledge the difficulties facing the Northern Ireland Housing Executive, and I call on it to formulate a plan of action to address the issues so that this Assembly can get to work and making it a reality. And I hope after the election we will actually have someone who will take it forward. Thank you.
I call Mr. Gerry Carroll.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I think people have said already, but this is a very important issue. And we know, everybody knows, that people are living in homes that are not warm enough. We know that people have to pay a fortune in gas and electricity bills just to heat their homes. And we know that the people think twice about turning their heating on. I think it was mentioned by Fran McCann, but we know that people put on coats and extra jumpers indoors because they're watching the meter. They're literally watching the meter. And we know, tragically, we've saw people die in their homes because they're unable to heat them. So this is the reality in 2017. We also know, Mr. Speaker, that 35% of heat in a home is lost if there's no cavity wall insulation installed in a house. So if you have an oil tank and you put £200 in it, you're losing £70 right away, because there's no cavity wall insulation. And I think that needs to be publicised, that needs to be emphasised more, because it's a colossal waste of money and it's hitting people who can't afford it in their pockets. And contrast that with taxpayers' money going to funnel and heat empty sheds with 7-8 heaters on full blast. It seems to me, Mr. Speaker, there's one rule if you have connections instalment and another for everybody else. So this is a very serious issue, Mr. Speaker, and we have to ensure that people are heated, they're warm and they're comfortable in their homes. And we also, Mr. Speaker, have to ensure that people aren't robbed blind with spiralling energy costs because their homes do not have cavity wall insulation in them. And I sincerely hope, Mr. Speaker, that the intention of the motion is this, rather than, as Mr. McCann has alluded to, a underhand attempt to further undermine the Housing Executive. And we have witnessed in the past attempts to undermine the Housing Executive, to try and delegitimise it, to try and break it up with stock transfers of housing from the Housing Executive to private associations. Mr. Speaker, definitely not on our watch. So I really do hope that this motion is about providing support to the tenants to do what's expected of the Housing Executive as a public body, and to provide cavity wall insulation to tenants that's vitally needed. And Mr. Speaker, as well, I think we'll have to state that the Housing Executive should be allowed to borrow money, and it should bring all its homes, it should have the capacity to bring all its homes up to standard. And over the next 30 years, it needs around £5 billion to do that. And they should be allowed to do this. All the barriers that exist currently preventing them from doing it should be removed. And really, it's a clear point. It's an investment in housing for the future, but it's also to ensure presently that the housing is adequate for tenants in it. So obviously, the motion is about Housing Executive tenants, and there should be no delay in ensuring that the cavity wall insulation is implemented for Housing Executive tenants. But, Mr. Speaker, it would be remiss of me not to mention, as has been alluded to already, tenants in private housing associations, and people in housing associations too struggle to afford to heat their homes. They have to pay higher rents on average compared with people in Housing Executive. So the need for cavity wall insulation should be extended to people living in private housing associations as well. I will, yeah.
The member has made a number of references, others have around the chamber, to cavity wall insulation. And this perhaps takes the debate in a further direction, and that is who actually installs that cavity wall insulation. Would the member agree with me that this is an ideal opportunity both to return to and to continue to allow social enterprise organisations to be the lead organisation when it comes to the delivery of cavity wall insulation?
Member has an extra minute.
I could also, and also use the expertise that exists within the Housing Executive to do that. So Mr. Speaker, I think it's also worth has to be mentioned that last week in my constituency in the Riverdale area, tenants of Victoria Housing, who held a meeting organised by a resident to hold the Housing Association to account. And for decades, minimal work of maintenance and upgrade was done. And in most cases, tenants actually were forced to pay for themselves for work to be done on the properties. And that was on top of rents increasing year on year. And despite the organisation claiming to be a charity, the tenants were forced to pay through the teeth for rent, and this included pensioners and young families. And I think the lesson there, and the reason why I mention that, is they show what to do. If you're not getting the maintenance done, if work isn't being done by the housing executive or the housing associations, you have to get yourselves organised and fight and campaign until demands are met. And I also want to pay tribute to residents of Connors Court in Derry, who, after being denied essential health and safety insulation work, after being denied it for years, they got organised. They held an occupation in the Housing Association office. They demanded to meet the Chief Executive, and after initially he refused to meet them, the residents said they're not leaving until he meets them, and eventually the Chief Executive came down, and the work has since been completed on the residents' property. So for me, Mr Speaker, that shows that occupations and sit-ins
work. Member conclude his remarks. I call the Minister for Communities, Mr Paul Given, to respond to the debate. The Minister has up to 15 minutes.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. Well, I welcome this motion and want to thank my colleague, Mr Easton, for bringing it forward. And it gives me the opportunity to discuss not just cavity wall insulation, but also the long overdue investment in housing executive stock. Defective cavity wall insulation is not a problem limited to social housing. It can affect all tenures. The issue is complex, and a full understanding of the issues is only beginning to emerge. Addressing it may require substantial funding, and I want to make the point up front that the Housing Executive has a substantial maintenance and investment backlog. Before taking remedial action, the Housing Executive will have to consider cavity wall insulation in the context of all of the other priorities identified by the Stock Condition Survey, part of the DSD, Housing Executive Joint Asset Commission. All of these other priorities, including rewiring, kitchens, roofs, bathrooms, need to be addressed as part of the Housing Executive's asset management strategy. The Housing Executive has an investment require over the next 30 years of around $6.7 billion. This cannot be covered by rents alone, and the Housing Executive therefore has an investment backlog which is large and getting larger. Indeed, the Housing Executive ideally needs to double the amount that it is investing in its stock for the next 10 years in order to get back on track. So when members are talking about everything that they ideally want the Housing Executive to do, it's worth bearing in mind the responsibility of this Assembly to enable the Housing Executive to be able to meet this investment requirement. The Stock Condition Survey involved a comprehensive survey of over 25% of the Housing Executive stock, around 22,500 properties. This has given the Housing Executive a holistic understanding of its long-term investment needs, and as I said before, this currently stands at $6.7 billion over the next 30 years. This survey allows the Housing Executive to plan and prioritise investment over the long term, and again, I would not be so brave to tell the Housing Executive to ignore its professional advice and its thorough and comprehensive survey data and instead take an entirely different approach to investment planning. The planning of investment is an operational matter for the Housing Executive, and as Housing Minister, it is not my place to ask it to push one scheme or type of work ahead of another. Oh, well, yes.
Would the Minister agree, in relation to what he's just been saying, that all these problems would be eased, ameliorated, including house building and maintenance, if the Housing Executive were given sort of the right to power to borrow money on the market to fund sort of the work that we all know needs urgently done? Would he agree that that should be done? And if he doesn't agree, why not?
Well, the point is well made in terms of the resources that are required to meet the demands that the Housing Executive presents. That's a decision that ultimately this Assembly takes whenever budgets are allocated by the Executive and then subsequently voted through in this House, and that's something that obviously members need to be always cognisant of whenever these decisions are made. The Housing Executive does have the legal power to build, but of course we know because it can't borrow on the markets, it isn't a financially attractive option whenever housing associations are able to do that. In order for the Housing Executive to be put into the same position as housing associations, that would require a change to the Housing Executive. And that would be something that ultimately members will need to consider in the future, what framework they would want the Housing Executive to sit within. And it also ties into the issue around the reclassification issue that the Assembly is having to deal with. That's an issue that is going to have to be grappled with, and ultimately members will then need to take decisions as to where they believe the Housing Executive should sit and the type of functions that the Housing Executive should be delivering upon. That'll be a decision now and an issue that needs to be grappled with for the next Assembly, obviously, to deal with that. But the member raises very valid points. I will, yes.
Forgiven way. When I was Housing Minister in 2010-11, I conducted a fundamental review of the Housing Executive, which was based upon a number of principles, including protecting the institution of the Housing Executive, its legacy and its name. But one of the intentions behind that fundamental review was to prepare the ground to enable the Housing Executive to borrow from the market. That review concluded in March 2011. It was shared with the then Finance Minister in March 2011. It is now approaching March 2017. Could you explain that, given that preparatory work that was done, that's guarded against the DUP doing damage to the Housing Executive, why has the issue that Mr McCann has raised repeatedly today about borrowing against the Housing Executive assets not been resolved?
Well, obviously, I don't know the detail around what went on in 2011, but let me just make it clear, no one's interested in damaging the Housing Executive, nobody. I have to say I have the greatest admiration for the work that I see day in, day out, in which the Housing Executive go about their work. I've responded to members when they've raised issues in respect of the way in which points are allocated. There was a motion to do with intimidation points. Again, a review was announced as to how we could go about seeking to ensure that we have a selection scheme that is fit for purpose. So, but in terms of the question around 2011, I'm not in a position to give that answer. What I can say is, from I've come in to post, this has been an issue where I recognise the challenge for the Housing Executive, but ultimately I recognise the challenge of how are we going to provide the homes that our people need to have, and what is the best way to go about doing that. That'll be something that the Assembly will have to grapple with in the next mandate. In respect to the comments again I'd made, the Housing Executive does have substantial stock investment backlog to deal with, and there's many other investment requirements. Some of these may be a higher priority than replacing cavity wall insulation, for example. On foot of this, I would make one key point, that it must be remembered that the Housing Executive owns around 10,000 properties of non-traditional construction with solid walls. It also owns perhaps another 5,000 other solid walls properties, such as rural cottages and older terraced properties. The thermal performance of these properties is poor, and the vast majority have not been benefited from any improvements to their wall insulation at all. The insulation of these properties is the worst in the Housing Executive portfolio, and these properties are an obvious priority in terms of improving the stock. On the topic of cavity wall insulation, the Housing Executive has acknowledged that some of the cavity fill that was carried out in the 80s and 90s could now be improved upon. Some of the insulation has degraded through time, some of it was badly installed, and some of it might have been put into unsuitable cavities. No surveying of Housing Executive stock has been carried out that properly determines how this affects different types of stock. Different types of cavity, filled in different ways with different materials at different times, will all have aged differently. The first step the Housing Executive will take is to understand how much of a problem there is. And going forward, the Housing Executive is proposing to commission an independent comprehensive research project based on a survey of 1,000 cavity wall insulated properties. These will determine the impact that degraded or inconsistent cavity wall insulation presents in terms of thermal efficiency and potential health issues.
The Minister is talking about remedial action and how to improve things. I have a pensioner constituent, an ex-serviceman as it is, who complained of his cold house, and the Housing Executive acknowledged prior to September that there was no cavity wall insulation. Why is he having to wait right through the winter until after April before he will be insulated as part of a scheme, rather than ensuring, when this is clearly identified, it is carried out much more expeditiously.
Happy if the member wants to give me the details to follow up on that, to provide an answer for him, so that you can provide that to your constituent. Again, maintenance, these are operational decisions that are taken by the Housing Executive, but I'd be more than happy to follow that up for the member.
But I have written to the Minister on this issue.
We'll get a response to you. The research will also consider the suitability of properties for cavity wall insulation in terms of geographical location and construction type. This data will help to develop a robust methodology to deal with this problem in the long term. In the meantime, I'm sure that we all know of cases where there's cavity wall insulation that has failed and the issues are urgent. Cavity wall insulation can fail to such an extent that it causes problems for the householder, such as damp or mould, and in some cases it could affect their health. The Housing Executive has undertaken to address these problems immediately without delay, and over 200 houses have had their cavity wall insulation replaced this way over the past 2 years. This will be done either through response maintenance or, if relevant and sensible, through ongoing planned maintenance schemes over the next few years. The Housing Executive is committed to addressing both the energy efficiency of its properties and fuel poverty affecting its tenants. The Housing Executive will carry out a survey of the cavity wall insulation in its stock and use that to develop a longer-term strategy to address any systematic issues found in its stock. And in the meantime, serious issues that emerge will be dealt with through response or planned maintenance. Any major programme to remove and reinstall cavity wall insulation broadly across the Housing Executive stock would require substantial investment. This would have to be considered against other investment requirements, including the 15,000 homes without any wall insulation whatsoever. So, Mr Speaker, I will, yes.
Thank you, Minister, for giving way again. Do you acknowledge that if we ever get to the point where the Housing Executive can borrow against stock, the fact that there's now issues and borrowing from the European Investment Bank will become problematic because of the Brexit decision actually has impeded the capacity of the Housing Executive in the future to borrow at cheap rates to do the work that you've just been referring to?
Mr Speaker, that's certainly an issue that I've raised directly with London in respect of obviously the negotiations that will take place around Brexit about any impact in terms of potential investment through the European Investment Bank. So that's something that's been raised.
I appreciate the Minister giving way very briefly. The Minister will be aware that the way in which the European Investment Bank is constructed allows it to invest not only in European Union countries, but countries that are on the periphery of the European Union. Once Brexit happens, the United Kingdom will be on the periphery of the European Union, but still eligible for funding from the European Investment Bank.
No, I'm sure this will be a debate that will be played out over the next 6 weeks in terms of Brexit. And I think, in fairness, I've been pretty generous to everyone who's asked me to give way. But, Mr Speaker, let me just, first of all, thank the members for the contributions that they've made. Over the period of time in which I've been the Minister responsible, I've met with a number of MLAs. Fran McCann brought me to Divis Tower, somewhere that I didn't anticipate that I would necessarily ever get to visit. But I have to say, the people there are salt of the earth, and I could see at first hand the situation that they're having to live in. And of course, when I've met with Nicola Mallon, and she brought family to see me in terms of very serious housing needs that they have, whenever I've engaged with other MLAs in this House around housing issues, these are issues that I think we all can find common ground on. Yes, we'll debate and at times maybe disagree as to the best way that we want to meet those needs, but we all ultimately want to achieve the same objectives, and that is to provide the type of housing that people want to be living in. And there is excellent housing in Northern Ireland provided by our housing associations and the Housing Executive. They are maintained to an excellent standard, but there are people who are in houses that frankly are deplorable. I've been in them. I have witnessed at first hand the mould up on walls and the consequences that that has in terms of the individual's mental health and in terms of their physical health. So in all of these things, it is vital that we collectively recognise these issues. And I hope that in the next Assembly, We ultimately need to identify all of the things where we have common ground. Yes, there's going to be things that we will disagree with. Yes, there's going to be things that we will differ on. We need to work through them and tackle those obstacles whenever they arise. But when it comes to housing, ultimately, it's about meeting the need that exists and providing the best possible standards that the people expect us as politicians to provide. I think Mervyn asked me to give way, and I'll do that.
I thank the Minister for giving way. And as a former Minister for Housing in this Assembly, I want to concur with the last comments that the Minister has made in relation to this issue. I see comments being made today about lost opportunities. And I think that as this Assembly comes to an end, members, let's face reality. It's most likely that we will not be back in this institution in the way that it is formed and the way that it is. So let's all bear the responsibility of what has happened over the last number of weeks. But the one lost opportunity has been, and across the benches, the members know opposite, that I endeavoured to ensure that we tried to find a solution to housing. If there is one thing we need to sort in Northern Ireland, it is to give to our people good quality homes. And I concur with the Minister's comments, and I look forward to a day when the people in Northern Ireland will be able to share right across the piece the benefit of good homes.
I remind the member that interventions should be short. Can I check if the Minister has now finished? Minister's finished. Can I call Mr Gordon Lyons to wind up the debate on the motion, and the member has up to 10 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr Speaker. And I want to begin by saying that there are some in the chamber today who have alluded to the fact that the reasoning behind today's debate was to have a go at the Housing Executive, or in some way to discredit the Housing Executive. I want to make clear that that is certainly not the intention behind this motion whatsoever. As a constituency representative, I'm in contact daily with the Housing Executive, and I very much appreciate the work that they do and how responsive they are whenever we raise issues or queries.
Would the member not agree that perhaps then they should have reflected on the wording of the motion, because it certainly comes across as a failure on the Housing Executive's part?
No, I don't, because I think that I can praise the work of the Housing Executive. I think I can appreciate the work of the Housing Executive, while at the same time, as a public representative, want to hold them to account and want to highlight where problems are. Because that is our job as public representatives in this place. Yes, it is to support the work of our public services, wherever they may be. But we also have a duty to hold them to account, the same way in which we have a duty to hold our ministers to account. But I do want to make that clear. This is not an attack on the Housing Executive. I want to thank the mover of the motion, Mr Easton. And he has certainly been consistent and persistent in relation to this issue. And he and I have been involved in meeting with different people in relation to this, and we have also met with previous DSD ministers, including most recently Lord Morrow, when he was in post. And this is an issue that Mr Easton clearly cares about, and indeed all members here have cared about, because I think the tone of the debate today has been largely positive. And I think that's because there has been agreement amongst members, and because we understand that there is an issue here, and there's an issue that needs to be dealt with, and party politics should be pushed to the side. The South Eastern Regional College report was clear. Over two-thirds of Housing Executive properties that were surveyed have either critical or severe needs, and only 9% are fit for purpose. And we all have personal experience of going into constituents' houses and seeing the problems that there are with damp and with cold, and with constituents who tell us that they never really feel the warmth in their homes. And that should be something that should be of a concern to all of us. And to go back to Mr Allen's point, I will want to hold the Housing Executive to account when they repeatedly tell my constituents that the reason that their homes are damp, or why they have problems there, is because of lifestyle issues and not airing out the home. Another reason why it's so hard to heat homes is because some of my constituents have had to keep windows open in order to get rid of the smell of damp. So this is an issue that does need to be addressed, and this is an issue that we should be saying to the Housing Executive, action needs to be taken here. I don't think anybody is under any illusions in regards to the work that needs to be carried out, the scale of that work and the cost of that work. But that doesn't mean that we shouldn't press on this issue and seek to ensure that this is addressed. There are a number of reasons why we need to tackle the issue of cavity wall insulation or the lack thereof. The first is because of fuel poverty that we experience in this country. And I know it's an old figure, but 42% of people in Northern Ireland are classified as being in fuel poverty, far higher than in the rest of the UK. It's estimated that almost 290,000 people are living in fuel poverty. So if we can take some action to address that by improving insulation in homes, surely we should be doing that. This can also cut costs in the long term, as other members have already alluded to as well. If our homes are properly insulated, it means that people will have to spend less money on heating and will have more money to spend on other things. And of course, keeping people warm prevents health problems. And I've seen that in my own constituency with children that are suffering as a result of the conditions in which they are living. So we do need to have an assessment of our Housing Executive properties. We do need to have an assessment of the ways in which that can be tackled. But the Energy Saving Trust has said that cavity wall insulation is the single most cost-effective, low-risk energy efficiency measure available for existing housing stock after loft insulation. So here we have a real ability to help our constituents. And indeed, in addition to that, it has been estimated, again by the Energy Saving Trust, that the cost of these insulation measures can be paid back in as little as 2 or 3 years. So this, of course, is an area in which we should take action. Mr. Speaker, I don't want to spend time going over all of the points that members have raised. One of the reasons why is because the points were repeated again and again. But I think that time and time again, we realise that the scale of this problem and that action needs to be taken. And Nicola Mallon and Andy Allen both raised the issue of housing being a human right. And not only should it be that we should provide and make sure that our people have homes, but homes that are up to the right standard, as Mr. Allen outlined. Mr. Dixon's contribution was largely positive. He wasn't. He lowered the tone slightly at one point, but we'll move beyond that. But of course, he did very much show his age by telling us just how long he has been married and how long ago it was that he was elected to Carrickfergus Borough Council. But again, he raised the point that this has consistently been an issue over many years. I thank the Minister for. I'll give way to Mr. Dixon.
I'll take it as a compliment that the member acknowledged my length of time as a locally elected representative, but would he not also agree with me that it is a terrible shame that we have had to wait, and indeed continue to wait, that length of time to see any genuine or real action? And that is the sad reality of what we're talking about today. Very little action and a great deal of annoyance to people whose properties suffer in this way.
Well, of course, that's why we're bringing the motion to the House today, and that's why we're calling for action to be taken in relation to this issue. But I agree with the member that we would love if this had been addressed a long time ago. And he obviously had these issues 40 years ago when he was first elected, and it continues to be an issue today. I thank the Minister for his comments, and he did obviously bring, as ministers need to do, a realism to the debate in regards to the financial constraints that are there, and we recognise those that he is working under. But of course, we have already mentioned that there is the opportunity to create savings in the long term by investing in this way, and that's not limited. Just 1 second. That's not limited to the Housing Executive, but also to other savings that can be made across public services, including, of course, health as well. I welcome the fact that he said that we need to have a longer-term strategy, and that in response to that there needs to be the plan maintenance. But if substantial investment is required, I believe it is incumbent upon us to make sure that that investment can be found, so that our people can live in homes that are fit for them and that are not detrimental to their health. Just want to say one more thing, Mr. Speaker, before I finish, and Mr. Storey has already alluded to this. We are in the last number of hours of this Assembly, and we will soon... No, because I want to finish my point. And we're soon about to vacate this place as we head to an election, and we do not know what is going to come next. I have been in this House for about 17 or 18 months, and we have had numerous debates in that time. However, a debate like today shows, in my opinion, the importance of having devolved government and not direct rule, because we, as locally elected Assembly members, are able to come into this place and raise our concerns and press upon the Minister the issues that our constituents are bringing to us. If we do not have a devolved government in this place, then we are the worst off for it. So I welcome the fact that we've been able to bring this motion to the House, and I'm pleased with the response that we have, and I hope that all members will support it. Thank you.
Members, the question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it.